Next on American Movie Classics, it's Heroism on the High Seas. Jeffrey Hunter stars as a British Navy man who outsmarts a German U-boat crew in the absorbing World War II drama, Sailor of the King. It's next on American Movie Classics.
My Blue Heaven was David Wayne's first film musical. I couldn't get used to him in that hat. How did you like the takeoff on South Pacific, performed by Betty Grable and Dan Daly? Producer Saul Siegel was worried that Ezio Pinza, who played Emil in South Pacific on Broadway, would be upset by the way he was satirized in that. But Pinza thought that Dan Daly's performance was very funny indeed and gave his approval to the number. There's another bit of irony concerning South Pacific, as long as we're on that subject. Mitzi Gaynor, who was making her film debut, later starred as Nellie in the film version of South Pacific, which I'm sure everybody saw here in American Movie Classics. And one final bit of trivia. At the time of making My Blue Heaven, Jane Wyatt was married to financier Edgar Ward. One of the couple's close friends was Admiral Richard Byrd, who had recently returned from an expedition to Antarctica. While he was there, he named a mountain after his friend, and not just any old mountain. Mount Jane Wyatt has a greater concentration of minerals than any other peak in the region. So truly, you'd have to say that her career took on new heights. I'm sorry about that. We'll be right back. But first, let's take a look at this.
In June, American Movie Classics has a proposal for you. Say I do and engage yourself in great movie entertainment. Attend the star-studded nuptials of some of Hollywood's most romantic couples. Come center stage for a dazzling curtain call. Plus, it's a day for Dad with our heartwarming Father's Day lineup. First, church bells ring and you're invited. Take a trip down the aisle with Hollywood's favorite brides and grooms.
After 7 years of wedded bliss, the lady is still in love with her husband.
Marriage turns to mayhem for Julie Newmar and James Mason in The Marriage Go-Round. Charles Boyer and Jennifer Jones hear wedding bells in Clooney Brown. Carol Lombard and Jimmy Stewart are made for each other. Gracie Fields teams up with Monty Woolley for a lighthearted look at unholy matrimony. Laurence Olivier and Joan Fontaine star in the Oscar-winning Rebecca. And a dashing Cary Grant comes to Ginger Rogers' rescue once upon a honeymoon. Also this month, American Movie Classic sets the stage for a spectacular curtain call. Anne Bancroft, Shirley MacLaine, and Mikhail Baryshnikov star in a towering story of love, rivalry, and jealousy.
Would you like to change places? I don't get 19 curtain calls anymore.
The Turning Point, nominated for 8 Academy Awards. Then, Rosalind Russell portrays an actress accused of murder. The Velvet Touch, Katharine Hepburn and Ginger Rogers lead an all-star cast as would-be actresses looking for their big break, Stage Door. And Betty Grable is irresistible in 2 backstage comedies, Diamond Horseshoe and Meet Me After the Show. On Sunday, June 21st, we're honoring dear old Dad.
This comes as quite a shock to me.
First, it's William Powell in Life with Father, co-starring Irene Dunne and Elizabeth Taylor. Cary Grant moves the family to the suburbs. Mr. Blandings builds his dream house. Clifton Webb stars as the unwilling father of the bride in Elopement. John Mills teams up with real-life daughter Haley Mills in the suspenseful Tiger Bay. And Jimmy Stewart is the reluctant family man in Frank Capra's It's a Wonderful Life. Plus, happy 100th birthday, Hollywood. In celebration, we've got 2 big showstoppers on June 24th. Janet Gaynor and Frederick March team up in the original Oscar-winning A Star Is Born. And Don Ameche and Alice Faye star in Hollywood Cavalcade. It's a month of love, limelight, and laughter. June on American Movie Classics.
We're back, and before we continue, I'd like to remind you that in June, American Movie Classics is going to pay tribute to Alec Guinness, who has a new book out. One of the screen's most versatile character actors, always fascinating to watch. He literally changes his entire personality to fit each role that he plays. In The Man in the White Suit, for example, he plays a scientist who invents a fabric that repels dirt and it never wears out. While the idea is a terrific one, the fabric's very existence causes a panic, of course, in the business world. Joan Greenwood and Cecil Parker co-star in this one. It's a delightful play. Then, in the delicious comedy, The Captain's Paradise, Alec Guinness this time is a carefree ferry boat captain with a wife on either side of the channel. Celia Johnson is his very sensible wife, and Yvonne DiCarlo is her sexy counterpart. This is a great idea, too. It's a merry chase of bigamy, very British style. So be with us in June. for these two very witty, unforgettable film performances by the great Alec Guinness. I'll be right back, but first here's something special from our film archives we'd like to have you see. American Movie Classics presents Newsreel Theater, featuring rare newsreel footage of historic people and events.
Pageantry and propaganda, swastikas and Sieg Heils. It is a time of darkness for Europe and the world, the fateful night that precedes the terrible dawn. Adolf Hitler, German Chancellor and Führer. He dominates Europe as no other leader does in January 1939. The Rhineland, Austria, the Sudetenland. Adolf Hitler has reclaimed, annexed, or occupied them all. Neville Chamberlain, England's aging prime minister. He speaks confidently of peace in our time.
We regard the agreement signed last night and the Anglo-German naval agreement as symbolic of the desire of our two peoples never to go to war with one another again.
Benito Mussolini, Il Duce, the father of modern fascism. Once he was the teacher and Hitler the pupil, but times and positions have changed. Benito Mussolini is the junior partner in the Berlin-Rome Axis. Last of 1939's Big Four is the Premier of France, Edouard Daladier, dedicated to the preservation of European peace, no matter the price. March 16, 1939. The German Reichstag hears Adolf Hitler proclaim the death of a nation. Nazi troops, he says, are occupying Czechoslovakia to protect the country from possible aggression. It is less than 6 months since the Führer at Munich promised an end to all German territorial and political expansion. Adolf Hitler has broken his word, defied England and France, and gone unchallenged. Berchtesgaden makes the decision that will plunge mankind into a Second World War. Poland will not yield the territory he demands, and so he will attack on September 1st, 1939. The war he launches, the attack he carries out, is like no war or attack in history. Hitler's war is a lightning war.
Adolf Hitler and his war machine have added a new word to the military vocabulary, the word blitzkrieg. At last, the bells have tolled. England must act. King George VI comes to number 10 Downing Street to confer with Prime Minister Chamberlain. Winston Churchill and Anthony Eden are summoned. England has promised to come to Poland's aid if she is attacked. September 3rd, 1939, England keeps her promise. America hears the momentous news by radio from Elmer Davis.
Britain went to war against Germany today, 25 years and 30 days from the time she entered the war of 1914 against the same enemy. France is expected to follow suit within the next few hours.
The war that England did not want nor seek has come, and trenches are dug in the parks of London. Sandbags are piled against ground floor windows in anticipation of enemy air raids that will come and be far more horrible than anyone can imagine. Caught up in the crisis are children too young to know or understand what is going on around them. The gas masks they wear are like toys for some, but to others, the masks are frightening and terrifying things. Thousands of the younger boys and girls will be evacuated from cities to rural areas. Many of them will not return to their homes again for 6 long years.
This is Edward Murrow speaking from London. There were more German planes over the coast of Britain today than at any time since the war began.
Thousands of years out of the Stone Age, civilized men, women, and children return to living like cavemen. England, undaunted, awakens each day and carries on. Although Poland falls in less than a month and Hitler's legions are free to attack England and France, all remains quiet on the Western Front. The French are determined not to attack. Our defenses, says Edouard Daladier, are impregnable. Cornerstone of French resistance is the vaunted Maginot Line, a labyrinth of corridors and catacombs housing 500,000 men. But there is one fatal flaw. France is fighting the war of 1939 with the men, weapons, and strategy of 1918. While Germany's Watch on the Rhine turns into a Sitzkrieg, and Nazi troops broadcast music to the French, the days dwindle down. September, December, 1939-1940. The Blitzkrieg strikes again. The seeds of appeasement and unpreparedness have provided Adolf Hitler with his greatest victory. France falls in 5 weeks. The Führer is absolute master of the European continent, the most powerful ruler since Napoleon. This is his day of days. This is his moment supreme. On June 22, 1940, Adolf Hitler, the vegetarian, enjoys a simple victory banquet as he awaits the formal French surrender at Compiègne.
This is William L. Shirer speaking from the forest of Compiègne, where Adolf Hitler today is handing his armistice terms to France. It is 3:15 p.m. Adolf Hitler strides slowly toward the little clearing. I can see his face, this grave, solemn, yet brimming with revenge. Off to one side is a large statue of Marshal Foch. Hitler does not appear to see it. Now we see the French walking down the avenue, led by General Hunsinger. Hitler and the other German leaders rise as the French enter. General Keitel reads the preamble to the German armistice terms. This whole ceremony is over in a quarter of an hour.
The last time I saw Paris, her heart was warm and gay. I heard the laughter of her heart in every street cafe. The last time I saw Paris, her trees were dressed for spring. And lovers walked beneath those trees, and birds found songs to sing. I dodged the same old taxi cabs that I had dodged for years. The chorus of their squeaky horns was music to my ears. The last time I saw Paris, her heart was young and gay. No matter how they changed, I'll remember her that way.
You're watching American Movie Classics. As we celebrate the flag-waving 40s all month long on American Movie Classics. American Movie Classics proudly presents two legendary performers.
How long is it since we've seen each other?
Cary Grant.
If I didn't have your best interest at heart, you think I'll waste my time arguing with you?
And Rosalind Russell.
Wasting your time, Walter, won't be a bit of good.
In one of the greatest comedy classics of all time.
No kidding.
Yeah, that's right, and it's a pip.
I can see the billboards now. It says, line up with Hildy Jones.
Oh, wow, stop that.
Howard Hawks, His Girl Friday, Thursday, June 4th on American Movie Classics.
This month on American Movie Classics.
I'm going to spend some time here. I'd just like to know who winds the clock.
Dick Powell's in town, and he's looking for trouble.
Trouble and I are old enemies. We understand each other.
He's a smart-mouthed detective on a dirty mission in the West.
If I weren't in uniform, I might teach you a few manners.
If you could teach me anything, you wouldn't be in a uniform.
To track down a man who's committed a crime.
This is a dangerous job that can get you killed.
Don't look so grim. It's only your gold and my skin.
But it's the lady with all the answers.
Are you always this sweet to the men who fight over you?
Only the winners.
Whose innocence is in question.
I almost had to have you killed.
Get on that horse and ride him till he dies. And then run until you have to crawl, and you might be lucky.
Destination Station West. Sunday on American Movie Classics.
We're back. I hope you enjoyed that selection from the old film archives. Audiences attending the premiere of our next feature, Sailor of the King, on September 2nd of 1953... underwent something of a shock. Just as the film seemed to be reaching its exciting conclusion, it was interrupted by a message that appeared on the screen. The audience was informed that they were about to enjoy a unique experience in moviegoing. They were going to see not one, but two endings for this film, and then they were to decide which would become the permanent conclusion. I'm not going to tell you which one they chose, just this. In one, the hero gets killed, and in the other, he manages to stay alive. Now, while you will not get a chance to evaluate the other ending, at least you can decide if you agree with the choice that was made. Despite the fact that this was a British project, the lead went to an American actor, Jeffrey Hunter. The young actor's first film experience had come only 3 years earlier on the campus of Northwestern University over in Chicago. He was cast in an experimental version of Julius Caesar, shot by the students. Hunter played the title role, but he was upstaged a little bit by one of his fellow students, a young man by the name of Charlton Heston, who played Mark Anthony. Well, a year after leaving Northwestern University, Hunter signed a contract with 20th Century Fox, where he quickly established himself as a boyish, handsome lead. He appeared regularly throughout the 50s and 60s and made a series of films with frequent co-star Robert Wagner. His co-stars today are two distinguished British actors, Wendy Hiller and Michael Rennie. Here they all are in Sailor of the King. We're back, and before we continue, I'd like to remind you that in June, American Movie Classics is going to pay tribute to Alec Guinness, who has a new book out. One of the screen's most versatile character actors, always fascinating to watch. He literally changes his entire personality to fit each role that he plays. In The Man in the White Suit, for example, he plays a scientist who invents a fabric that repels dirt and it never wears out. Well, the idea is a terrific one. The fabric's very existence causes a panic, of course, in the business world. Joan Greenwood and Cecil Parker co-star in this one. It's a delightful play. Then, in the delicious comedy, The Captain's Paradise, Alec Guinness this time is a carefree ferry boat captain with a wife on either side of the channel. Celia Johnson is his very sensible wife, and Yvonne DiCarlo is her sexy counterpart. This is a great idea, too. It's a merry chase of bigamy, pretty British style. So be with us in June for these two very witty, unforgettable film performances by the great Alec Guinness. I'll be right back, but first here's something special from our film archives we'd like to have you see.
American Movie Classics presents Newsreel Theater, featuring rare newsreel footage of historic people and events.
Ready to kick off now. They've just scored. Ace Parker did it. Jock Sutherland's boys lead the Giants 7-0. Here's the whistle. Merle Condit comes up. He boots it. It's a long one down to around the 3-yard line. Ward Cuff takes it. He's cutting up to his left. He's over the 10. Nice block there by Lehman. Cuff still going. He's up to the 25. And now he's hit and hit hard about the 27-yard line. Bruiser Kennard made the tackle.
We interrupt this broadcast to bring you this important bulletin from the United Press. Flash, Washington. The White House announces Japanese attack on Pearl Harbor.
Yesterday, December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy, the United States of America was suddenly and deliberately attacked by naval and air forces of the Empire of Japan. No matter how long it may take us to overcome this premeditated invasion, the American people in their righteous might will win through to absolute victory.
America goes to war. Farm kids and bank clerks, butcher boys and businessmen. Twelve million Americans will come or be called to serve their Uncle Sam. East, west, north and south, husbands, fathers, brothers and sons. Boys will become men, soldiers, sailors, airmen, marines. America's sons will be severely tested in the flaming forge of enemy fire. The time for testing, the moment of truth, will not be long in coming. August 7th, 1942, somewhere in the Pacific, 8 months to the day after Pearl Harbor. The target for the first American assault is an island so remote that no accurate map of it exists, an island called Guadalcanal. On Guadalcanal, without supplies or reinforcements, 16,000 Marines hang on and hold out for 38 brutal and bloody days. Against a fierce and fanatical enemy, the Leathernecks attack in advance, mile by agonizing mile. Tough as he is and must be, G.I. Joe is tender, too. Finally, victory comes on Guadalcanal. America has chipped away the first fragment of Japan's swollen empire. But World War II was a two-ocean war. The shadow of the swastika falls across all of Europe, and Adolf Hitler is master of the continent. The German Führer has vowed that the Third Reich will survive for 1,000 years. Yet the fortunes of war are already turning against the Nazi leader and his Italian ally, Benito Mussolini. By September of 1943, American and British forces have fought their way out of North Africa, across Sicily, and now they are firmly entrenched in the toe of the Italian boot. Moving up with the troops are the army nurses, the angels of mercy, with wet feet and big smiles, who face death and find greatness, shoulder to shoulder with the men they serve. On the rocky slopes of Italy, American GIs struggle forward, northward. Loneliness, a despair such as only a fighting man can feel and know. Families, loved ones, are not only miles but years away. And still, bone-weary and dog-tired, the foot soldier sweats out his loneliness and somehow manages a smile. K-rations and hardtack, day after endless day. Meatless days and empty shells. America is on short rations, too. Families are counting their coupons, figuring their points, as meat and butter, sugar and canned goods are rationed on a point basis. Housewives and homemakers live by the numbers, stretching their precious points as well as their budgets, giving up blue stamps for canned goods, red stamps for fresh meat. In wartime America, March 15th becomes a day of reckoning. Income tax exemptions are cut. Weekly withholding begins on July 1st, 1943. And John Q. Taxpayer starts his struggle with forms and finances. June 6th, 1944, D-Day. The largest amphibious assault operation in all of history is launched against Adolf Hitler's Fortress Europe. More than 170,000 men and 4,000 ships take part in the Allied landings on the beaches of Normandy. At British bases on crowded runways, every day is a day of battle for the American airmen who live from dawn to dawn, mission to mission. Thank you. claims 70,000 airmen, almost one-fourth of all American casualties in World War II. But the Allied planes that do get through play a vital part in the final defeat of Germany, pounding the industrial cities, the manufacturing backbone of the Third Reich. Yalta, in the Russian Crimea, the big three of World War II, Churchill, Roosevelt, and Stalin, meet for the last time. Never in peace will America, Great Britain, and Russia find the unity of purpose that they shared in war. Half a world away, U.S. fighting men are writing a new saga of high courage. 5,000 Marines die to claim the 8 square miles of a tiny volcanic island called Iwo Jima.
Man your battle station!
At sea, Japanese kamikaze planes carry out their suicide missions against American warships in a last desperate effort to turn the tide of the war. The carrier Franklin is gravely wounded off the coast of Japan, but Big Ben will not give up nor go down, although more than 1,100 crewmen are killed and wounded. ...1945. Germany is in her death agony as the Allies attack from the west, east, and south. Out of the aircraft that blacken the skies over the Third Reich comes a new kind of G.I. Joe, an airborne infantryman, jumping the Rhine and spearheading the final assault on war-ravaged, war-wearied Germany. On the ground, all roads lead to victory. Colon falls. Surrender talk is in the air, and tanks and trucks race forward, impatient to speed the day. Mile after mile, town after town, the American servicemen come and see and conquer. This is the day, the hour, the moment of liberation. Every GI is a hero, a symbol of a promise kept, a pledge redeemed. The end has come. The war in Europe is won. Adolf Hitler and the German Empire that he vowed would survive for 1,000 years, they both are dead. In the Pacific, General Douglas MacArthur strides ashore in the Philippines, fulfilling the fateful words he spoke after the fall of Bataan and Corregidor, the words, "I shall return." The ordeal of internment that began with the fall of the Philippines is at an end. America has kept the soldier's faith. And back among his men, MacArthur can say, "I'm a little late, but we finally came." August 6, 1945, an American bomber named the Enola Gay, after the pilot's mother, delivers a single, awesome bomb on the Japanese city of Hiroshima. The people of Hiroshima do not know at first what has happened to them. Days pass before they learn that their tragedy marks the birth of atomic warfare and the final unconditional surrender of Japan. America celebrates and rejoices. The war is over. Peace has come. On September 2nd, 1945, aboard the battleship Missouri in Tokyo Bay, General MacArthur presides at the surrender ceremonies. It is a solemn moment as the general speaks.
It is my earnest hope and indeed the hope of all mankind, that from this solemn occasion, a better world shall emerge out of the blood and carnage of the past. I now invite the representatives of the Emperor of Japan and the Japanese government and the Japanese Imperial General Headquarters to sign the instrument of surrender at the places indicated. Restored to the world, and that God will preserve it always. These proceedings are closed.
And then it begins, the happy journey home for millions upon millions of soldiers, sailors, airmen, and Marines. Their job is done, their mission accomplished. America's freedom is preserved. To Main Street, USA, every city, town, village, and hamlet hails its sons and heroes. Peace has come, the war is over. And G.I. Joe takes his discharge papers, his ruptured duck, and his mustering out pay, and goes back to the civilian life he left 1, 2, or 5 years before. All across America, on 12 million streets and in 12 million homes, the story is the same. G.I. Joe is once again just plain Mr. Jones, back with his duffel bag and his memories. The world has changed. America has changed. He has changed. And none of them will ever be the same again.
Watching American Movie Classics. It was a time of war. A time for heroes.
Listen to him carefully and do exactly as he says.
A time when even love couldn't be trusted.
I know it's tough when the woman you love goes over to the enemy.
John Wayne leads the troops to victory. Anthony Quinn and Beulah Bondi co-star in the exciting World War II drama, Back to Bataan. Part of our salute to the flag-waving 40s, premiering Friday, May 29th on American Movie Classics.
God, you're lovely.
She's spirited.
I can't quite describe it. I feel chirpy.
She's talented.
Everybody calls me Clooney.
She's Clooney Brown. There's laughter and love for Jennifer Jones, Charles Boyer, and Peter Lawford in the sophisticated comedy Clooney Brown, part of June's Down the Aisle Festival, premiering Wednesday, June 10th on American Movie Classics. They may have lost the battle.
The damage to our bow has cut our surface speed in half.
But no way would they give up the war. John Wayne stars as the hard-nosed submarine skipper who launches Operation Pacific. Ward Bond and Patricia Neal co-star in the World War II naval adventure...
Hang on!
Operation Pacific. It's an American movie classic. Monday.
We're back, and before we present another film from our archives, I'd like to tell you that our film library is increasing all the time, and every effort is being made to find new and interesting pieces of film that represent really the growth of the film industry across the boards from the early times, the 20s and 30s, on up until now. We are looking for new classic movie moments. We've got some really special ones, too, that I think you'll enjoy. So, stick around. It gets better as we go along. Now, here's a good example of what I mean.
Another kind of comedy uniform. Straw hat and neat business suit. The uniform of Charlie Chase. Here, Charlie is approached by a lady who, as the original title put it, is after a husband. Anybody's husband. Charlie, of course, is happily married and 100% faithful, hardworking and of unbesmirched character. Yet he's forever being found in compromising situations like this. Hoping to ditch this young lady in a hurry, but politely, of course, he writes a message to the driver on his shoe. Charlie's wife, watching from the window, naturally sees all and assumes she knows all. Chase's forte was the farce of misunderstanding and embarrassment, with situations rather than slapstick dominating. Like so many of the clown princes, Charlie Chase's initial image on the screen was quite a different one, as here, where he is an unwashed, opium-sniffing bum. And the other fellow is not the other Charlie. It's Billy West, best of the many Charlie Chaplin imitators of the period. This 1917 comedy makes no bones about kidding such generally taboo subjects as drug addiction and effeminacy. West's outfit was so much Chaplin's in every detail that much of the public was fooled. In fact, when West finally gave up this stolen identity, he found no clear-cut character of his own, and audiences forgot him. Billy urges Charlie, give it up. It's making a wreck of you. For a moment, we think that a bit of moral crusading is justifying the kidding of an unpleasant subject. But it's not a moral lecture at all. Billy wants to try the stuff himself. Earlier, in the same picture, Playmates, Billy did a bit not as Chaplin, but as a child. And his partner, on the right, is Oliver Hardy. Incidentally, he was to repeat this child routine years later with the same outsized sets in one of his most famous talkies with Stan Laurel, Bratz. Later in the same film, the children, Billy West and Oliver Hardy, are grown up and still scrapping over the same girl. Note Billy's precise Chaplin technique. Hardy played for West the hulking villains or bosses that Eric Campbell and Max Swain played for Chaplin. Hardy also played the big heavy for Larry Seaman, one of the smallest comedians of all. Forever chasing and never catching. Now here's Hardy, minus mustache, with Charlie Chase, and not as a heavy, but as a straight man. This was the mid-20s. Chase was now a big star, Hardy still a minor comic. But most of the Hardy mannerisms have already formed. The twiddling fingers when perplexed. The bullish run. The long stare. Followed by a knowing nod. While Hardy was thus occupied, his future teammate, Stan Laurel, had been busy as a writer, comedy director, and star. In roles like this aggressive wise guy salesman, a far cry from the simpleton that was to become his ultimate screen character. Again, the gag is what today would be bad taste, kidding physical affliction. But the silence did it so well and so often that no one was really offended. Selling, but never making a sale. Stan tries a new pitch for his product. Like Chaplin, Laurel had come from an English music hall background. In fact, the two came to America together, and for a while appeared together on the stage. With the customer still unimpressed, Laurel takes revenge in one of those sudden bursts of fury that were to become a trademark of the later Laurel and Hardy comedies. In the two-reeler, Man About Town, Laurel, uncharacteristically to those of us who best remember the later Laurel, is pursuing a comely blonde. He himself is pursued by an enemy, the civilian, not the cop, who was to plague him throughout the next 20 years, Scotch comedian Jimmy Finlayson. Experienced as both Laurel and Hardy were at this time in the mid-20s, not until they joined forces as a team did they take their full place as clown princes.
You're watching American Movie Classics.
We're back, and tomorrow, Weekend Hollywood Gold returns with five of your film favorites featuring the movie's most exciting stars. Well, a lot of them, anyway. First, in the heartwarming drama Close to My Heart, Gene Tierney and Ray Milland are a young couple who are eager to adopt a baby. The process changes their lives, by the way. Next, in the Boy Meets Girl musical, The Sky's the Limit, Fred Astaire and Joan Leslie are the smitten pair. Then, in the 1880s western Strange Lady in Town, Boston-bred Greer Garson creates quite a stir when she becomes the first female doctor to set up a practice in Santa Fe. Dana Andrews and Cameron Mitchell co-star in that one. Then we have Anne Baxter and John Hodiak, who are along to star in Sunday Dinner for a Soldier, the movie's tribute to John Q. Public's many sacrifices to help the war effort in those days. Then James Dean makes his film debut in East of Eden, based on John Steinbeck's bestseller. This mighty drama of strife within a family co-stars Julie Harris, Raymond Massey, and Joe Van Fleet. Now, here's today's movie question. In what film did Marlon Brando boast, "You know what luck is? Luck is believing you're lucky, and that's all there is to it." I'll have the answer for you tomorrow. For American Movie Classics, I'm Bob Dorian.
In love with Hollywood romance on American Movie Classics. Claudette Colbert in the highlight of her dramatic film career.
I promised your father and I promised myself that all the things he planned for you are going to come true, war or no war.
A pillar of strength amid the tragedies of war. In David O. Selznick's Since You Went Away. With Jennifer Jones.
But just for the summer, Mother. I could be a nurse today, maybe.
Shirley Temple and Joseph Cotton.
Brig! That's what I call a real reception.
Since You Went Away. Coming soon on American Movie Classics.
Thank you.